Welcome to the lecture series on EC354. In yesterday's lecture, we had gone through the pinout diagram and then we had seen the instruction cycle and the machine cycles in detail. Okay? And we had gone through the concept of T states in a machine cycle. So, in the last lecture, we came to know that instruction cycle is comprising of an fetch cycle and execution cycle. Okay, means the instruction cycle is having these two components, that is the fetch cycle and an instruction and an execution cycle. Okay, and we have defined the machine cycle, and in that machine cycle we are having the different T states. Okay, so in today's lecture we are going in much more detail, and we will go through the individual machine cycles. Okay, that we had listed in the last lecture, that is the fetch cycle for fetch operation, and the different execution cycles like memory read, memory write, IO read, IO write. Okay, so every instruction that is being given to 8085 microprocessor to perform a specific task, okay, each and every instruction will take some time to do that. So we are going for the timing diagram. So by going through the timing diagram, we will exactly understand the working of the instruction by using the waveforms. Means timing diagrams are nothing but the graphical representation of an instruction, that what is actually going inside the microprocessor, that we are going to learn in detail. Okay, so let us go for the timing diagram or the graphical representation of an 8085 instruction. Okay, so basically in 8085, depending on the opcode or depending on the size of the instruction, we are having 1 byte instructions, 2 byte instructions and 3 byte instructions. Okay, all these instructions are temporarily stored in the memory, and microprocessor fetches the opcode from the memory and executes it. That we had seen yesterday while going through the instruction flow and the data flow for a particular instruction in a microprocessor. So that we had seen yesterday. Okay, so today let us start with the 8085 timing diagram. Okay, so let us first start with the opcode fetch cycle. Let us first start with the opcode fetch cycle. So while going through the graphical representation or the timing diagrams, basically these diagrams are being seen using a logic analyzer. Okay, so when a particular instruction is executing, we can put the logic analyzer on the pins of the 8085 microprocessor, and we can see the graphical representation of the signal that is coming at that particular pin. Okay, so we can observe exactly that how that particular instruction is working inside the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so let us go with the timing diagram. Okay, so initially the first signal which is being required, the first signal which is being required for the timing diagram is the clock signal. Is the clock signal that is being required in the timing diagram. Okay, now let us draw the clock signal. So that is comprising of T states, as opcode fetch cycle is having 4 T states, so we are supposed to draw 4 clock cycles. Okay, so we are having this T1 that I have drawn, that is the first clock cycle. Then we are having T2, So this is our T1, the first clock cycle or the first T state, then T2, the second clock cycle or the second T state, then we are having T3, then we are having T3, the third T state, and the last one in an opcode fat cycle. Okay, so that is the last one in opcode fat cycle, so that is T4. So we are having these T states in 8085 microprocessors for opcode fat cycle. Okay, so for opcode fats there are 4 T states, so we are naming it T1, T2, T3 and T4. Okay, in this, so this is the clock signal. Now the duration for this clock period depends on the crystal frequency that we are connecting to the pins crystal 1 and crystal 2. Okay, so in yesterday's lecture we had seen that we are connecting 6.14 megahertz clock signal to crystal 1 and crystal 2, and half of that is the working frequency for the microprocessor, so that is approximately 3 megahertz that we are giving. Okay, and when we go with T, so that T is nothing but 1 upon F, the working frequency of the microprocessor, so that T is equal to 1 upon how much? We'll get 3 megahertz. Okay, so that is 1 upon 3 megahertz. So normally we will get 0.9 microseconds as this one T state. So one T state represents over here represents 0.9 microseconds for the working frequency of how much we are having? 3 megahertz approximately. So for approximately 3 megahertz working frequency, this T state, the individual T state is of 0.9 microsecond. Okay. So let us proceed further with the graphical representation for the opcode fat cycle. Okay. So the first signal I had plotted, that is the clock signal. After then, the other signals which are being required are, that is, IO or memory, means it is performing an IO operation or memory operation. Okay, so that signal will be put in. Then we are having this data bus status pins, that is S1 and S0. So data bus status pins will be there, that is S1 and S0. Then we are having the high order address bus, that is A8 to A15. So we are taking a bus instead of a signal. Okay, so we are taking A8 to A15 signals collectively. Okay. Now see that in the same way we will take the low order address bus, that is AD0 to AD7. That is the low order address bus, and finally we will take the signal ALE, that is address latch enable, and the read signal. So these are the control signals and the address and data bus lines, okay, which we are supposed to monitor while we go for the timing diagram. Okay, so during T1, let us see what status we have on all this, and we are going for an opcode fat cycle. Okay, so let us assume that an instruction is already stored, means the opcode of an instruction is already stored inside the memory, and microprocessor is trying to fetch that opcode from the memory. So how actually it will work? So during T1, as the microprocessor is performing a memory operation, means it is going to fetch the opcode from memory, so IO and memory pin will become active low for T1, and for opcode fetch it will go throughout logic 0. Okay, so for all other T states also we will make this IO or memory 0, because opcode fetch operation is related to memory only, because it is going to fetch the opcode from memory only. Okay, so for opcode fetch, what we will do, we will take IO memory pin at logic 0 for all the T states. Okay, so during T1, IO memory, we will get a logic 0 because it is having a memory operation. Okay, For fetch operation, the database status value of S0 and S1 will be at logic 1. Okay. So both S0 is equal to 1 and S1 is equal to 1 that we had seen yesterday in the pinout diagram. So throughout the operation, that is opcode fetch, this S0 and S1 status lines, it will show the fetch operation in the data bus. So we will take logic 1 throughout the diagram. Okay. Now what actually happens during T1 is that initially the address from where the opcode is to be fetched is supposed to put on the address bus. Okay. So this address/enable signal is being activated. Okay. So initially this ALE signal is being activated during T1. So due to this activation of address/enable signal during T1, what will happen? On the higher order address bus, as soon as it will see the address, the program counter high value will be put into the high byte of the address bus, that is A8 to A15. So A8 to A15 continuously, that is a pure address bus, so that will take PCH, means program counter high, is loaded into the high order address bus. Okay. So during T1, what will happen? The ALE signal, the address/enable signal, is being generated by the microprocessor, and the program counter high is put into the address bus, that is A8 to A15. Okay. And the low order multiplexed address and data bus is demultiplexed, and now it will initially work as a pure address bus. So during T1, it will work as a pure address bus, and program counter low is being loaded onto the address bus. Okay, so during T1 it will work as A0 to A7, and that 16-bit address will be there from A0 to A15. Okay, so during T1 address fetch enable is being given, so address is being put onto the address bus. Okay, at the same time, currently it is not performing the read operation, so read operation will be at logic 1 as it is active low, so we are considering it as logic 1 during T1. Okay. Now during T2, this is again at logic 0 for memory operation. For fetch operation, S0 S1 will show 1 1. This is the high order address bus, it will have the program counter high. Now as the address fetch enable is disabled during T2, now from this memory location, that is program counter high and program counter low, it will make a 16-bit address. So on that address, whatever the opcode is there, that is being put into the data bus during T2, because this ALE signal is being deactivated during T2. Okay. So during T2, what will happen? During T2, now it will behave as a data bus, and the opcode is put into D0 to D7. The opcode is being put into D0 to D7 during T2. And at that time, during T2, this read signal will be activated. Now ALE signal will not activate, so we are putting it at logic 0 from T2 to T4. Okay. So during T2, this read signal is being activated. So microprocessor reads opcode or fetches the opcode from the memory, and it will put the opcode into the data bus. Okay. Now T3 is the wait state, means the microprocessor waits for the fetch data. So there is a fraction of time which is being required by the microprocessor to fetch the data from the memory. Okay, so that timing is being provided by the T3. So T3 is the wait state. Okay, so till T3 we are supposed to put the read signal until the microprocessor recognizes it. what is to be done, and until T3 it is being available, this opcode is available, okay, and this opcode is available till T3, okay, and in T4 it is being decoded and executed, okay. So T3 will provide some time so the data can reach to the microprocessor, okay, and then in T4 it is being decoded and executed, okay. So let us take an example of a 1 byte instruction. Let us take an example of 1 byte instruction. Like if I take a 1 byte instruction like move A comma C, okay. So for this instruction there is an opcode, okay. So let us say that the machine code for this instruction is stored at 2000H, okay. And let us assume that the machine code or the opcode for this instruction is, let us take, it can be any value, okay. So I am just assuming any random value right now for the machine code, okay. You can get the exact value from the reference table in the lab, okay. So if this machine code is stored at 2000H memory location, then using the timing diagram we can explain the working of this instruction, okay. So you can see that during T1 what will happen, the ALE pulse is being given and the address is being loaded into the high order address bus, okay. So in high order address bus, what will be the program counter high? In our case it is 2000H, okay. So the program counter high will become 20H and program counter low will become 00H. It will become 00H, okay. So the program counter low will be 00H, program counter high will be 20H, okay. So that address is being coded into the address bus. Is it clear? Okay. See, when we are using the address as a, or when we are going for a bus is nothing but collection of wires, okay. So when we are going to expand this, okay, you are supposed to take 8 wires to represent 20H, okay. So convert it into binary and that particular level will be there, okay, for 20H. Is it clear? That is from A15 to A8. You are supposed to expand it and put it the binary levels, or in a bus you can directly write 20H. So this is the bus that we are representing. Okay. So PCL we are having 00, PCH we are having 20. So that address is being put in onto the address bus. During T2, when the ALE is being deactivated and the read signal is being there, the opcode from that memory location, on that memory location, if this opcode is there for move A comma C, so that opcode XXH will be loaded into the data bus and that is being transferred to the microprocessor. So to transfer that data to the microprocessor, it will take some time. So that time is being given by T3, that is the wait state, okay. So that wait state will provide the timing, and during T4 it will go to the instruction register. Then the instruction decoding circuitry. So it will decode the instruction and then it will be executed, because both the operands A and C are inside the microprocessor. So when the microprocessor gets the opcode for move A comma C, microprocessor finds that in this instruction the contents of C are copied into accumulator. Okay. So now after decoding the instruction, the contents of C register is via data bus, they will go to the accumulator. Okay. So both the operands are inside the microprocessor, Okay, that's why only one instruction or one machine cycle is required for this instruction, that is the opcode fetch cycle. So in the opcode fetch cycle, the instruction is being fetched from the memory as well as being executed by the microprocessor. Okay, so for all 1 byte instruction or for most of the 1 byte instruction, we are having only one machine cycle which is being required by the microprocessor, that is opcode fetch cycle. Okay, so that is in most of the 1 byte instructions. Okay, is it clear? So for other instructions, we do have a separate execution cycle in terms of memory write cycle, memory read cycle, IO write cycle, and IO read cycle. Okay, IO write and IO read is related to the IO devices, and memory read and memory write is for memory devices. Okay, so this is all regarding the opcode fetch cycle. Okay, then let us proceed further in the discussion. Let us proceed further and let us try to see the timing diagram for another instruction. Let us try to go for MVI A,12H. Okay, now let us say that this instruction is again stored at 2000H. Okay, so at 2000H, when you hand assemble it, you will get the opcode for MVI S3E, and on 2001H you will get this data, that is 12H. So it is a 2 byte instruction. This is a 2 byte instruction. So for this kind of 2 byte instruction, the first machine cycle is always opcode fetch. So initially this 2000 address will be there. So instead of this, what it will take? It will take 3EH, okay? And that is being transferred to the instruction register. And when this instruction is decoded, it will find that one of the operand is not inside the microprocessor. Okay? One of the operand is stored in the memory, which is external to the microprocessor, in case of 8085 microprocessor. Okay? So in this case, it needs one more fetch cycle, okay? So that we are supposed to discuss, okay? So this 12H is supposed to read from the memory, and then it is being transferred to which register? Accumulator register in this instruction particularly, okay? So the next machine cycle which is being required for this instruction is memory read cycle. Means from memory, this 12H is being read, and that is being transferred to the accumulator. Okay, that is your MVI A, the 8-bit data. Okay, so let us see the memory read machine cycle. Okay, let us go for the memory read machine cycle for MVI instruction. Okay, so this will be our machine cycle 1 that we had gone through, that is the opcode fetch. So 3 is already fetched. Okay, now see that during M2, that is the memory read. Okay, that is our memory read machine cycle. It will take 3 T states. It will take 3 T states. Okay, so let us go for the 3 T states. So this is the first one. Then a second one. And the last one, the third one. It will take 3 T states. These are the 3 T states. So we are having T1, T2 and T3. Okay. So for this, as again it is a memory operation and we are doing a memory read for MVI instruction. So IO over memory will be at logic 0. Okay. Now we are performing a memory read operation. It is not a fetch operation. Okay. So for this, the value of S0, the value of S0 and S1 will change. So this is our S0 and this is our S1. So S0 will become 0 and S1 will become 1. Okay, for memory write, memory read operation. Okay, so for memory read operation, the value of S0 will be 0 and memory and the value of S1 will be equal to 1. Okay. Now the program counter high value, the program counter high value during T1 will change now for the next memory address. Okay. So during T1 again and address latch enable signal is being activated. Okay, so because of this address latch enable signal which is being activated during T1, the high order program counter, so that is your high order bus will have, that is your program counter plus 1 for high order. Okay, so over here we are having on 2000H we are having 3EH that is already being fetched. And on 2001H we are having this data, that is in our case we have taken 12H. Okay, for the instruction MVI A, 12H. Okay, for this instruction we are taking this. Okay, so that is program counter high plus 1 in our case. Okay, so that will be again 20H is there. 20H will be there. Okay, for this case 2001, so this 20 will be the program counter high value. Okay, and after then in program counter low again there is address during T1, so it will be program counter plus 1, that is for low. Okay, so that is how much it will be 01H now. So on this 2001, this 01 will come in the program counter low and we don't have the active read signal. Okay, so during T2 what will happen, during T2 this read signal is being activated again. Okay, this read signal is being activated again during T2. So during T2 again it will put the data, it will put the data into, this data is how much, 12H. Okay, so that is being put, this data is being put into the data bus 12H. Okay, this ALE is not active throughout the signal. So during T2 the read signal is being given and during T3 it is being transferred to the microprocessor. And by using the internal 8-bit data bus, it is being stored into the accumulator register. Okay, so till T3, the data is available on the data bus. Okay, so this is the timing diagram for MVI A, 12H that we have gone through. Okay, and it is having two machine cycles. The first machine cycle is opcode fetch machine cycle and the second machine cycle is the memory read cycle. Okay, so in memory read cycle we are again considering the same signals. Okay, and again we are going for a memory read operation. So for memory read operation during T1 an AL equals is being given, so the address bus will have the address 2001. During T2 the read signal is being activated and the data is being read from the memory and is being loaded into the data bus and that is available to the microprocessor in T3. So the instruction is being executed by the microprocessor in two machine cycles. Okay. So total T states which is being required for MVI A12H is 4 plus 3, that is 7 T states are being required. So you can calculate the time which is being required to execute this particular instruction by the 8085 microprocessor. Okay. So this is the timing diagram for opcode fetch and memory read machine cycle. Okay. In some cases, in some books, you will find only a memory read machine cycle like this. Okay, the signals are same. Okay. So basically, the first cycle is always opcode fetch cycle. Okay, and this is going to vary depending on the instruction. So for this particular instruction, it is a memory read cycle. Okay, so this is the memory read cycle that we have seen in detail. So let us proceed further in the discussion with the other cycles, other machine cycles, which have been required for the different instructions in the 8085 microprocessor. Okay. So let us proceed further with memory write machine cycle. Okay. So let us go with the memory write machine cycle. Okay. Again, in the memory write machine cycle, now we are going for memory write machine cycle. Okay. In this also, we are going to consider the same clock signal. Okay. So the same clock signal we can draw. So this one is the T1. Okay. So this is the T1. Then we are having T2. So this is T2, and the third one, that is the last one for a memory write also. So we are having 3 T states for this machine cycle, so that is T3. Okay, so we are having 3 clock cycles, that is T1, T2, and 3 T states, that is T1, T2, and T3. Okay, so this is the clock signal, as we are having the same thing in the memory read also. Okay. The other signals are the same that we have put it, that is IO or memory. We are having S1 and S0. Okay. We are having A8 to A15, the high order address bus. We are having AD0 to AD7, that is the multiplex low order address and data bus. We are having ALE signal. Now, it is a memory write operation, so the last signal we are supposed to use write, not read, as we are doing in the memory read. So the last signal will be the write signal. Okay. Now in this, as it is a memory operation, so the IO or memory is always low throughout the whole machine cycle. Okay. Throughout the whole machine cycle, it is a memory operation, so IO memory will be at logic 0. Okay. Now in this, S0 will become logic 1, S1 will become logic 0. Okay. So this is our S0 is equal to 1, and we are having S1 is equal to 0 for a memory write operation. So data bus status pins is going to show you this value. Okay. Throughout the machine cycle. Now, during T1, when the ALE pulse is being activated, okay, during T1, when the ALE pulse is being activated, the address to which the data is to be put on the address bus. Okay, so for an example, if we are writing STA instruction, if we are writing STA2050H, okay, means the contents of accumulator is going to store at this memory location. So the last machine cycle for this is memory write. So the contents of accumulator are supposed to store at this memory location. Okay, so that during T1, that address is being put into the address bus. Okay, so that address is being put into the address bus during T1. So it will comprising of address, that is A8 to A15. Okay, and over here we will get A0 to A7 the address for the same. Okay, so basically there are two registers which will take care of this address which is not visible to the programmer. These are the W and Z registers. Okay, so that value is loaded into the high order address bus and the low order address bus. Okay, during T2, when this read signal is being provided, this write signal is being activated, it is an active low signal, same as the read signal. So during T2, this write signal is there, so that data is being put into the data bus, that is D0 to D7. Okay, and that data will be stored into this memory location. Okay, so it will take some time, so that is the time for execution is being there for T3. Okay, so during T3 the instruction is being executed. Okay, is it clear? So in our case this will be 20H, this will be 50H, and for an example the contents of accumulator are 02H. Okay, so D0 to D7 will be 02H. Okay, so at the end this 2050H memory location will have 02H for this particular instruction, that is STA2050H. Okay, so the contents of the accumulator is stored to the memory location. Okay, so this is the memory write operation. Okay, so up till now we had gone through these three machine cycles. Up till now we have gone through the three machine cycles, that is the opcode fetch we have gone through, memory read we have gone through, and memory write machine cycle we have gone through. The two left which are IO read and IO write. Okay, the difference between memory write and IO write is of only IO and memory pin. Okay, the main difference is IO and memory pin is the first difference. So if I want to make a IO write machine cycle, if I want to make an IO write machine cycle, then this IO or memory signal, this IO or memory signal will be at logic 1, because it is an IO operation, so this will be at logic 1. This IO or memory pin will be at logic 1 for IO operation. Okay, for IO operation the value of S0 S1, okay, that is for the write. So for write operation it will again change, so this will become S1, this will become S0. So this is your S1, this will become S0. Okay, that is the status pins for the write. Okay, for write operation it will not change. For write operation it will not change. Okay, so that is your S1 and S0. That is your S1, S0. Okay, so this is the S0 value will be 1 and S1 value will be 1 that we had seen during the pinout diagram. Okay, for write operation it will not change. Now, as far as the in and out instructions are there, for in and out instruction In the operand field, we are having only 8 bit. That 8 bits are nothing but the port address. Okay? So while we are going for an IO write operation, this address will be the 8 bit port address in both program counter high and program counter low. Okay, so this will be the 8 bit port address. Okay, so that will be the 8 bit port address, and over here also that is the 8 bit port address. So we are having the 8 bit port address on the address bus. Okay, therefore write operation, contents of accumulator are being put onto the data bus. Okay, so contents of accumulator are being put onto the data bus, and during T3 that is being put into that port address. Okay, so if the port address is 01H, so the contents of accumulator, for an example, if it is 22H, so that is being sent to the 01H port address. Okay, is it clear? The same changes you can make for an IO read. So for IO read, instead of write, there will be read signal. Rest of the things are same. Okay, so from that port address, the value is being read, put it into the data bus, and that is sent to the accumulator during T3. So that will be the IO read operation. Okay, so we are having this 5 machine cycles, out of which opcode fetch is fixed for every instruction, and depending on the working, this variable execution cycle we are having. Okay, so out of this IO read IO write is for in and out instruction only. Okay, so rest of the instructions is going to have memory read and memory write as an execution cycle. Okay, so keep in mind that all the one bit instructions, they will have only one machine cycle. Okay, that is the opcode fetch, that is the fixed one. Okay, so all one byte instruction of 8085 microprocessors, they will have only one machine cycle, that is the opcode fetch. Okay, and opcode fetch is having 4 D6. In the same way, most of the 2 byte instructions, the first machine cycle is fixed, that is opcode fetch, and the other machine cycle can be memory read, memory write, or IO read, IO write. Okay, is it clear? Or combination of this machine cycles. Is it clear? So in today's lecture, we had gone through the timing diagram and we had seen the machine cycles in detail, and we had gone through the opcode fetch, memory read, memory write, IO read, and IO write machine cycle. So depending on the functionality of the instruction, you need to judge that how much is the size. Okay, that you can find out by hand assembling it by the size, but by going through the functionality, you actually came to know that the first one is the opcode fetch, and the others are the combination of this. So instruction cycle or the full machine cycle is comprising of these small machine cycles. Okay, so the full machine cycle is your opcode fetch cycle plus the execution cycle. Okay, and for all one byte instructions, there is only one opcode fetch cycle. Inside that, the execution of the instruction is also being done. Okay, for others, there is a variable execution cycle. So out of that, only one instruction we have gone through. Okay, so you can practice by your own for the other instructions also. Okay, so only one instruction that we have gone through is the MVI A,12H. Okay, and the only opcode fetch I have shown you for one byte instruction like MOV,C. So it can be same for the add instruction also, or it can be same as for all one byte instruction also. Okay, so that we have for today's lecture. Thank you very much for watching.